is a financial statement analysis which really covers the inference we can draw from a particular financial statement and how it is interpreted or how it is useful in the decision making, financial decision making. So today's resource person is Mr. Kirot Chandra Maharana, and who is the academic consultant with Odisha State Open University, who is a very focused faculty in the commerce. And along with that, I welcome Mr. Prithviraj Mishra. Sir, welcome. And Dr. Anshuman Jena, who is giving the technical support in this session, I welcome you. Before I request Mr. Kirod Maharana, sir,
Yes, sir.
I may request Prithviraj sir and Anshuman sir to share few words for at least 1 minute each. So after that, Kirod sir, you can start. Okay.
Cheers.
Anshuman sir, please.
Dear learners, it is a golden opportunity for you to directly interact with the resource person and get all your doubts, questions, queries clarified. So please ask as many questions as you can ask and make this session interactive and make the most out of it. This is my only request to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jena. Thank you, Paricha sir, for giving me an opportunity to speak few words. As Dr. Jena has rightly told, this opportunity in this situation is really a golden opportunity. And the novel initiative taken by the university is widely appreciated. Coming back to the topic, financial statement analysis, I would like to add only one thing, that all of us have experience in meeting a doctor at some time or other, whether for self or for our parents. Whenever we meet a doctor and express our problems, that sir, I'm feeling headache, weak, whatever it is, then the doctor prescribes certain tests, blood test, x-ray, BP, sugar, so many tests are conducted. Then, studying the reports that we get, the doctor prescribes certain medicines to cure the illness. So far as financial statement analysis goes, then we have got before us the performance card, the grade card of the organization. Now we conduct certain tests to know how the health of the organization is. Even if we don't have any illness, we go for medical checkup to know that we are all right, our health is all right. Like that, these tests are various ratios. In the course of discussion, you will come across ratio analysis, common size statement, how two statements are compared by taking the percentage of sales figure, what decisions are to be taken, what are the various liquidity ratio, to know to what extent our liquidity position is okay. Then we test the profitability of the organization by means of profitability ratios. Then we also test the strength or weakness of the organization by various turnover ratios. They're all in brief about the financial statement analysis. Analysis is not done only for the sake of analysis. Financial statement analysis is a continuous process to interpret the various results so that we can ascertain whether we are going in the right direction, where we should take more efforts to set right the position, or what should be done in future course of action so that our organizational objectives are achieved with less cost. There should not be how to prevent waste, how to reduce cost. All these decisions are taken based on the financial statement analysis. Friends, financial statement analysis is itself a very interesting topic, and also it is vital to understand why a financial statement analysis is done. Thank you very much. Sorry, Hirod, I took some more time, and now I request to go on and go with the financial statement analysis. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to speak few words. Thank you, Parichar sir. Thank you, Jana sir. Let us go ahead with Hirod sir.
Thank you, Professor. You have really explained many things in nutshell. It was really wonderful. And thank you, Dr. Jana. Now it is the time to take over by our resource person, Mr. Kirat Marana. So, Kirat sir, it is yes. Now over to you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all. And now we will start our session. And today's topic is analysis of financial statement. So in this previous class, we had already discussed discussed by Dr. Biswamohan Jena, what is a financial statement and how to prepare a financial statement. So that is in your block 3. And today we will be discussing block 4. This is the analysis part of our financial statement. So let me first say what is a financial statement. As you all have discussed in the previous class, so still I want to say, a financial statement means a statement which contains financial terms. Okay, so these are the reports prepared by company's management to present the financial performance of a particular business concern or a financial position at a particular point of time. Clear? Then the financial what are those financial statements? Financial statements includes a balance sheet, or we can say position statement, the income statement, okay, the cash flow statement. So these all are financial statements which are usually prepared by any business concern. Clear? Okay, so why we are preparing these statements? So these statements are prepared for the users, mostly the users who are outside the company, like investors and creditors. Investors are those who invest money in the company. Clear? Creditors are those who grant loan to the company. So though they invest money, they must be, they all have the right to know about what is the financial performance of a particular business concern. So they must get the detailed information about the financial position of a company. So these they can get the information through what? Through a statement called financial statement. Okay. Okay. So these the table of contents, the courses or the segments which we are going to cover today is financial statement analysis, ratio analysis, trend analysis, comparative and common size statements. Okay, so financial statement analysis means it is about introduction to financial statement analysis. Then types of financial statement analysis or methods of financial statement analysis. So in the method there are ratio analysis, trend analysis, comparative statements and common size statements. Okay, now what are the objective of financial statement analysis? Means why we need to analyze our financial statement. So there are various objectives. So the very purposes of analyzing the financial statement is, the first objective is assessment of past performance and current position. Clear? Okay. We all know that our past performance is often a very good indicator, or it gives signal for our future performance. Okay, so therefore an investor or a creditor who invest money must know the trend of past performance, like past sales, past profits, past cash flow, what is the return on investment. So these things the creditors and the investors should know to access by accessing the past performance and the current position. Then only they can decide about the future, whether to invest, whether the company will go for a long run period or whatever. So accordingly, this past performance is a gives an indication or a very strong signal for future performance. Clear? So during the by doing the financial analysis, we can analyze the past performance of the company. Clear? The next objective is prediction of net income and growth prospects. Okay, prediction of net income and growth prospects. So financial statement actually helps in predicting the earning prospects as well as the growth and the development of a company. Clear? So the investors can compare the various alternatives, so investment alternatives, and other users also can judge the earning potentiality of the business enterprise. So prediction of net income means, as in the first point we have already discussed, the past performance, analyzing the past performance. So it can by analyzing the past performance, the company can predict the income and also overall growth of a company, which are going to happen in the future. They can, they cannot accurately predict, but mostly they can do an overall prediction of the growth prospects of a company. Then the third objective is prediction of failure and bankruptcy. Clear? So it is, the financial statements can be a very important tool, clear, in predicting the failure of a business. Why? Because any business organization, how it is performing, and what is the probability that it will achieve success or it will achieve failure. So in financial analysis also we can predict the bankruptcy and failure of a business concern. Clear? So accordingly we can also take preventive measures to avoid this failure or to minimize the losses. Clear? Then the next point is loan decision by financial institutions or bank. Okay, loan decision means, as the banks or other financial institutions are supporting the organization by providing loan and various financial assistance, so they also invest money by granting them loan. So they will be also interested in a scrutiny of access to the financial statement, and they analyze those statements, and they judge the solvency of a business concern or the liquidity position of a business concern, whether the business concern is capable enough to pay all the liabilities and the obligations. Clear? So financial statement analysis used by the banks or other loaning agencies, clear, to make a sound credit decision. It makes them easy to decide to grant credit to a company or not. Clear? By financial analysis, they can properly allocate the credit among different borrowers. Clear? Okay. So it also helps the financial institutions or the agencies who are going to grant loan, it helps a lot to them in determining the risk of credit. Risk of credit means what? Whether we invested money in particular fund or in a particular organization, whether we will be getting back in return, clear, within a stipulated time or not. So there is always a financial risk involved in that. So the financial statement analysis helps us to determining the credit risk, the extent of risks involved in granting credit to various companies. Clear? Okay. Point number 4 is complete. And then types of financial statement analysis. Okay, broadly there are two types of financial statement analysis. One is horizontal and vertical analysis. So while horizontal analysis, it is done in a company's financial statements over a time. Over a time means over different time periods. Clear? And vertical, whereas vertical analysis looks in each item of a financial statement in a particular year. Clear? Srimay sir.
Hi.
Sir, I think some disturbance is there. Okay. Now yes. Now it's clear. So vertical analysis means when each and every items are being judged and a percentage of a base figure within the same period is determined. Clear? Say for example, in horizontal analysis, we suppose calculate the sales figure of 2010 and the sales figure of 2011. So what is the difference between the two sales figure? Because we took the sales figure of two different periods, whether the sales figure has increased or decreased, or if increased, to what extent it has been increased, and whether it is or whether it is decreased, whether the sales figure declines, and what is the reason for decreasing the sales figure. So these things have to be analyzed in vertical analysis. Clear? So sorry, in a vertical analysis, in a horizontal analysis, the items of different period are analyzed, such as sales figure of what I have just told, sales figure of 2010 and 2011. But in case of vertical analysis, we analyzed the sales figure. Suppose in a vertical analysis, we analyzed the any item in comparison to total sales, in any of the assets in comparison to total assets. So if the total assets amounting to this, and we are going to determine what is the proportion of a particular asset, say plant and machinery. So what is the proportion of plant and machinery in comparison to the total assets of a firm? So this is called vertical analysis, or analysis of items within a particular period or in the same period. Okay, but in the horizontal analysis, there is a comparison of a particular item in different period of time. So we will be discussing it later in detail. First of all, I would like to say that horizontal analysis is otherwise known as comparative statement analysis, and vertical analysis is otherwise known as common size statement analysis. Clear? Okay. Later we will discuss about these two statements with examples. Then the next slide is, sources of financial information. Sources of financial information means what are the sources. If let's say an example, I am a investor, or I am a shareholder of a particular company. So I need to analyze the financial reports. Okay, so that it will help me to take further decision regarding the investment, or regarding the investment in the company. So what I will do, I will collect the information, I will collect the financial reports of a firm, so that I can able to analyze the report for my future decision making purpose. So there are various sources of financial information. The first one is company reports. Company reports means every company publishes annual reports. Annual reports is a very vital report. It is specifically published for the shareholders, as the shareholders has reports, the company publishes the annual reports to the shareholders. So it contains the director's report, it contains the financial statement, it contains all the schedules and notes to the financial statement, it includes the auditor's report. So these are various reports, these are various company reports from which the various financial information can be accessed by a financial analyst to have further further analysis of this financial reports. Then the second is stock exchange. Okay, stock exchange, actually they maintain the library of annual reports of various companies. The companies who actually invites shares to the public, the company has to enlist its stock in a recognized stock exchange. So whenever a company is enlisted in a recognized stock exchange, it is the duty of stock exchange to maintain the annual reports of the company. So the annual reports can be also a very vital source of information for the purpose of financial statement analysis. Clear? Sometimes what happens, the stock exchange also, they publish the consolidated reports. Consolidated reports mean it is not the detailed report, it is the summary of the annual report of the company's performance, so that it will encourage more and more shareholders to invest in a company. So stock exchange can be also as a very source of financial information. Then the business periodicals. Business periodicals means the business newspaper, such as there is various business newspapers published in India, such as Business Standards, Economic Times, business magazines such as Business India, Business World, Dalal Street Journal. So these can be used as a source of information for further analysis of our financial statement. Okay. Then users of financial statements. So who are the users of financial statement analysis? Suppose a financial analyst is going to analyze a particular financial statement, so there must be users of that. So user, who are those? The users are those who takes interest in the company, who are more concerned about the profitability of the company, who are more concerned about the growth and development of the company. So who are the users of financial statement? So first is creditors and suppliers. Clear? Creditors and suppliers are actually interested in the company's ability to pay their obligations when they become due, when they become due. So creditors are those who lend money or who grant loan to the company. So they must be more concerned about that, whether the company has financial capacity or whether the company is capable enough to pay its duties, to pay its liabilities or obligations. So they are more concerned about the liquidity position of a firm or the company's ability pay the short-term obligations and dues. Okay. The next user of financial statement analysis is owners or the investor. Okay. Owners means in a traditional form of organization, owners and management are same, as all of you know. But in company's form of organization, owners and investor. Investor means stockholders or the shareholders of the corporation who need all the financial information to help them make vital decisions, okay, on what to do their investment. Clear? What to do with their investment. So whether they can hold the investment, whether they will be they should sell the investment, or whether they should buy more. Okay, so it is specifically for the shareholders of the company who holds the share of the company. So it depends on the financial results of a particular business concern, whether the shareholders will sell the share, or it will buy more, or it will just hold the share for a further rise in price, and when the price will rise, they can sell or whatever they can do. So it actually helps them to take vital decisions. Okay, then the third user of financial statement analysis is the management. Okay, so management as I have already told that in management, in every small business concern, management includes the owners. But in a huge organizations, however, the management is usually formed or made up by hiring the professionals. Clear? Hiring the professionals means if in a big organization, they operate in a large scale, so the owners usually don't manage the business. They prefer to be only owner of a business organization. But so in a huge organization who are operating in a large scale, they actually hired professionals, okay, who are actually entrusted with the responsibility of operating the business. So they got the responsibility to operate the business and for achieving all the growth and success for the business. So here they can also be called as an agent of the owners. Okay. Then the next user is government. Government means government is also interested in the financial statement analysis. Why? Because government means specially I am telling about the tax authority. Tax authority who are interested in the entities' financial information, okay, for taxation or other regulatory purposes. Okay, so taxation authorities means they are more concerned about the profitability of the business, because it's very common that when the company will earn more profit, then the company is liable for payment of more tax to the government. So the government will take already so the government will take interest in the users, take interest as a user of financial statement analysis. Then next is employees. Employees are actually interested in company's profitability and stability. So suppose I am an employee of a particular company, so I should be more concerned about its profitability and also stability, because a stable organization means the employees are more secured for a long-term run of a concern. So it is the ability of the company to pay salaries and provide all other the benefits to the employee. All other benefits means I am the employee of the organization. So I should always see that whether the company can able to pay salaries, whether the company is stable enough that I can continue here for a long run period. Clear? Then the next user is the customer. Customers are actually interested in the companies that they judge the company's ability to continue its existence, okay, and also maintain the stability in operations. Okay, so they dependent because they are customers of the company or the clients of the company. So they must be knowing, they should know whether the company is going in a positive way or it is going towards success or towards growth or towards development. So customers can be a customer is a user of can be a user of the financial statement analysis. And the general public includes everybody. It may be general public means research. General public can be a researcher, can be an analyst, can be a student and other interested person who are somehow related with the companies for some valid reason. So these are the users of the financial statement analysis. Clear? Then limitations of financial statement analysis. Limitations, despite of various positivity or various advantages, there are certain limitations also. Clear. So first limitation is not a substitute of judgment. Not a substitute of judgment means judgment cannot be always right in case of the financial statement analysis. But it is the reason is that when we are calculating certain things as per the quantitative terms or in terms of numbers, so it somehow cannot give the accurate result, and tentatively we can judge or we can take decision, but the this is not, but there is no any necessary that the decision we have taken is right and right to 100%. So it is not a substitute of judgment. It means only a it can only be a mean or a mean to reach the conclusion. Clear. Ultimately, the judgment are taken by the analyst or the interested party based on their intelligence and skill. Okay. Though the numerical conclusions help them, but the ultimately they are taking decisions regarding the company as per their skill, experience and intelligence. So this is one limitations of financial statement analysis. The second one is based on the past data. Based on past data means we cannot see the future. So we are just analyze the financial statement as per the past data. Whatever the business has achieved and what are the numerical figure actually exist in the past data, the past financial statement, past balance sheet, past statement of profit and loss account. So only past data of accounting information is included in the financial statement, okay, which are actually analyzed. The future cannot be just like past, or in fact the future can never be like past. So the analysis cannot provide a basis for future estimation, for future forecasting, or any type of future budgeting or any type of future planning. So it is based on the qualitative term. That qualitative term means our experience, our skills. These are actually mostly required to take a decision. Okay, so as I have already told that the numerical figures helps, no doubt they will help, but ultimately we, the human being, will take the decision. Okay, then the next point is problem in comparability. Comparability means so the business is all about competition. So we should always look forward to compare, to compare ourselves, comparison with others, comparison and also comparison with ourselves. So problem in comparability means there are various procedures or rules, regulations, methods, tools. These are actually used to prepare any financial statement. So when the problem of comparability arises, when the company or the particular organization, they actually change the existing method. Clear. Say for example, the method of calculating depreciation. Okay, yesterday Dr. Biswamohan Jena sir already described about depreciation and the methods of calculating depreciation. So there is various methods such as written down and straight line method. So written down method means the depreciation is charged on the diminishing value or the remaining value of the assets, whereas in the straight line method the depreciation charge on a fixed assets is equal every year. So in the meanwhile, so if the organization is adopting if the organization has adopted straight line method in few years, and after few years the company will change its method of depreciation, then it becomes very difficult to compare the data, because the amounts will vary. The amount which will come out will be very confusing. So that time the problem of comparability arises. Okay, then the next point is reliability of figures. Reliability of figures means the figures which are actually we get after preparing the financial statements may be manipulated by window dressing. So there is a term or buzz in financial accounting, window dressing. Window dressing means it is a clever manipulation by the clever manipulation who actually prepares the financial statement. Clear? So clever manipulation means what I will do, simply I will postpone the cash payment. Okay, let's take a very simple example. I have to pay cash for certain things. Simply, I will postpone my cash payment. So whenever I prepare my financial statement, the amount of cash shows a very high value. So it is what the others or the third parties or whoever is accessing my financial statement, they think that, oh, the company has a very high cash balance in hand. So this is a clever manipulation, or various other manipulation also made, though it is illegal. So some clever manipulation is made in the financial statement so that the output or the final result looks good. So again, the reliability of figures means, though the figures are manipulated, so the reliability is on the figures is sometimes misleading or meaningless also. So this is also an limitations of the analysis of financial statement. Then the next point is change in accounting method. Okay, this method I have already told. So if the method of adhering the accounting policies, so we are actually change in the mid year. Suppose in the past few years, we are adopting a particular policy or particular rules or particular method of calculating certain things, and we suddenly changed our decisions, and we decided that in the future, we change the method and we change the method of calculation of certain things. Then there will be very difficult or very complexity arises in comparing the amounts. Financial statement analysis becomes very difficult. Okay, then the changes in the value of money. Changes in the value of money means when the value of money changes. In the economics, we have a term called inflation. Inflation means what? When the money money loses its purchasing power. Loses its purchasing power means whatever the things we can purchase with a particular amount, gradually the time. During the passage of time or gradually the time passes, the same amount of money has a less purchasing power. Say for example, we are purchasing a samosa of rupees 5. Clear? But 10 years earlier, we are purchasing the same samosa with rupees 1. So this is what money loses its purchasing power. Clear? So the purchasing power of money is reduced from 1 year to subsequent year due to inflation. It also creates a very problem in comparative study of the financial statement of different years. Clear? And the next limitation is limitation of the tools application for analysis. Clear? Tool application of analysis means the same point, a particular tool or techniques is based on the skill and experience of the analyst. So tools application means, suppose an analyst wants to analyze a financial statement of a business concern, and he adopted such and such tools. Because he adopted particular tool to analyze the financial statement, and another analyst may adopt a different method. So it depends on the analyst to what tool or what techniques he is going to adopt or he is going to implement while analyzing the financial statement. So it depends. So there is another limitation that whatever tool a particular analyst is adopting, it is not necessary that an other analyst will follow the same rule or techniques. Then no assessment of managerial ability. Managerial ability means the result of the analysis of financial statement is an indication of the good or bad management. Hence, the managerial ability cannot be accessed by the analyst, by the analysis. So this is a numerical output only. So by the numerical output, we cannot access the ability of a particular manager. He may be more efficient or he may be more skillful, but with a mere numerical result, we cannot analyze. Okay. Then the last is change in business condition. Change in business condition means the business condition or circumstances or the environment. We call it as business environment of 1 year to the subsequent 1 year and another year can never be similar. Hence, it is very difficult for an analyst to analyze and compare one firm with another or one organization with an other. So these are the limitations of financial statement analysis. Okay, we will move to the next slide. Then we come to the main topic, which is methods of financial analysis. Methods of financial analysis means what are the tools available to analyze the financial statement. There are actually plenty of tools, but the major tools are ratio analysis, trend analysis, comparative statement, common size statement, funds flow analysis, cash flow analysis, cost, volume, profit analysis. So in the list, there are other analysis also, such as break-even analysis. So in your syllabus, we will be studying only four. Ratio analysis, trend analysis, comparative and common size statements. Clear? Then first we will study ratio analysis. So what do you mean by ratio? Ratio means it is a very important analytical tool for financial analysis. It is a mathematical method of ascertaining different financial ratios of a company. Okay, ratios means there should be some items. So items are taken from the financial sheets or the financial statements which are actually publicly available. Clear? It is analyzed to know whether the company's to judge the company's performance. So ratio analysis is used to evaluate the number of issues with an entity, such as liquidity, efficiency, operations, profitability. So these are broad heads. Clear? Under these heads also there are a lots of ratios which are actually determined to know the strength and weakness of a particular firm. So it is a quantitative method of gaining insights into a company's liquidity, operational efficiency and profitability by studying its financial statements. Okay. Then the next slide is objective of ratio analysis. Okay. So we are just reading it out. I am just reading it out. So it measures the profitability. Profitability means how the firm, how a particular business concern is running towards profit and whether it is achievable or not. So these things we can judge by profitability ratio. Clear? As profit is the ultimate aim of every organization. So I say, suppose a particular firm earns a profit of 5 lakhs of rupees last year. So how we would determine whether the 5 lakhs is sufficient enough, or whether 5 lakhs is good enough, or it is a bad figure for the company. So we can judge the particular amount of profit, whether it is good or bad, by doing the profitability, by determining the profitability ratios. Clear? Then the evaluation of operational efficiency. So there are various operating ratios also. Operating ratios actually tells the operational efficiency. So how efficiently the operational activities of a particular concern is executed. Clear? So there are also certain ratios who actually determines or who highlight the degree of efficiency of a particular company. Clear? Okay. So there are various operational ratios, such as efficiency ratios, turnover ratios. They actually tells whether there is an unnecessary expenses, how to avoid the whether there is unnecessary expenses, and how the financial resources can be allocated, whether there is a mismanagement of assets. So various things which we can be evaluate through operational efficiency. Then ensure suitable liquidity. Liquidity means, as all of us know, liquidity means the ability of a particular firm to pay off its short-term obligation. So how liquid a firm is? How liquid a firm means what are the liquid assets of a firm to pay the short-term liabilities? Liquid assets means who the assets which are already in form of already in the form of cash, or it can be converted into cash immediately within some days or within a very near future. So these are called as liquid assets. So it ensures the suitable liquidity means whether the firm is capable enough to pay the liability. So liquidity ratio actually means when we determine the current ratio or the acid test ratio or quick ratio. These actually help the firm to maintain the required level of short-term solvency. So this actually ensures the suitable liquidity of a particular firm. Then the next point is overall financial strength. Overall financial strength means it is about the long-term solvency of a firm. Suppose debt equity ratio. Debt equity ratio means debt against the equity. What is the company's debt and what is the company's equity? Various leverage ratios. So it actually guide us to judge the overall financial strength of a business concern. Then the comparison. Comparison means it enables to compare to other industries standard to get better understandings about our financial health. So we should always compare with others as well as we should always compare with ourselves. So that there are two types of we can also compare our statement with other company statement. We can compare or we can analyze our statement of different periods. We can also compare various items placed in our financial statement within a particular year also. So there is a scope of comparison. So this is another objective of ratio analysis. So then types of ratio. Broadly, the ratios are divided into four types, such as profitability ratios, liquidity ratios, activity or turnover ratios, and solvency ratio. So first of all, we would like to start with profitability ratio. So what is a profitability ratio? It tells about the business capability or ability to generate earnings. So how far a business is capable to earn profit, to how far a business is capable to generate the profit. So by determining the profitability, various profitability ratios, we can able to judge the capability or the ability of the business to generate earnings. Okay. So first of all, profitability ratio includes various types of ratios such as net profit ratio, gross profit ratio, price earning ratio, operating ratios, expenses ratio, dividend yield ratios, dividend payout ratios, रिटर्न ऑन कैपिटल एम्प्लॉयड रेशियो, अर्निंग पर शेयर और ईपीएस रेशियो, रिटर्न ऑन शेयर होल्डर्स इन्वेस्टमेंट रेशियो, रिटर्न ऑन इक्विटी रेशियो. सो वी विल बी स्टडिंग ऑल दिस रेशियो इंक्लूडिंग द फॉर्मूलाज वन बाय वन. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल नेट प्रॉफिट रेशियो. नेट प्रॉफिट रेशियो मीन्स, नेट प्रॉफिट मीन्स द नेट मार्जिन ऑफ ए बिजनेस. ओके, सो नेट प्रॉफिट रेशियो इज वेरी पॉपुलर प्रॉफिटेबिलिटी रेशियो. इट शोज द रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन नेट प्रॉफिट एंड नेट सेल्स. नेट प्रॉफिट मीन्स ऑब्वियसली नेट प्रॉफिट आफ्टर टैक्स. सो वी कैन ऑल्सो दिस इज द फॉर्मूला. नेट प्रॉफिट रेशियो इज नेट प्रॉफिट आफ्टर टैक्स डिवाइडेड बाय नेट सेल्स. सो हाउ नेट सेल्स मीन्स ग्रॉस सेल्स माइनस सेल्स रिटर्न equals to net sales. So net sales of the company and in relation to, sorry, the profit of a company, net profit of a company in relation to the net sales of a company. It establishes the relationship between the net profit of a company to the net sales of a company. If we can also multiply the formula multiplied by 100 to achieve the achieve the result in percentage. Higher the percentage means higher the profitability of a business. Clear? So net profit, this is all about net profit ratio. The next is gross profit ratio. Gross profit means the overall profit of a business concerned. Clear? The gross profit, arrived at the gross profit by, it is the trading result. We can say the trading result of a concern means it is the difference between the selling and buying of a particular business concern. And gross profit also includes all the direct expenses. Okay, as all of you know, direct expenses are the expenses which are related to either purchase or production related activities of a particular organization. So gross profit ratio is equals to a gross profit divided by net sales. Clear? It shows the relationship between gross profit and net sale. It can be a very useful tool or a popular tool which evaluate the operational performance towards the business operational performance of a business towards profitability. Clear? So this is all about gross profit ratio. Then the third ratio is price earning ratio. Price earning ratio means, or we can popularly call it PE ratio. Price earning ratio means it shows whether the investors are willing to pay a higher price share today because of its growth the expectation of growth in the near future. So it will encourage the shareholders to invest. So it will a green signal for the shareholders that the shareholders, the share, the price of a share is going to increase in a very near future. So it can be calculated, the price, the PE ratio is calculated by market price per equity share divided by earning per share. Okay, then the next ratio is operating ratio. Operating ratio means it is, as the name suggests, it is the operational efficiency of the management. It showed, the ratio shows the operational efficiency of the management. So it also indicates whether the cost component in the sales figure, it is with normal range or not. Clear? Normal range or not means a low operating ratio means a high net profit. So it is calculated as operating ratio means operating cost divided by net sales. Operating cost divided by net sales, because it, the operating cost or the cost which is incurred in the operating activities or operating expenses, it is compared with the net sales. Clear? So higher the operating cost means it is a very bad signal for the company, because the cost is increasing in comparison to net sales. Clear? So it is all about operating ratio. Then the next is expenses ratio. Expenses ratio means it is operating expenses means all the operating cost was actually involved. So in the expense ratio or expenses ratio, it is a particular, it actually shows the relationship of a particular expenses in comparison to the net sales. Okay, any expenses, it may be wages, it may be rent, it may be salaries or whatever expenses or to a whatever expenses means a particular expense. A particular expense is actually considered in this ratio. The formula is that particular expenses divided by net sales into 100. Clear? So this is the this is all about expenses ratio. Then the next is dividend yield ratio. Dividend yield ratio means all of you know about what is dividend. Dividend is the amount which is paid by the company to the shareholders for the investment in shares. Clear? So dividend, it so what is dividend yield ratio? First of all, see the formula. Dividend per share divided by market value per share. Clear? Market value per share means whether the market value of share what is the market value of share? It is the whether it is sold at a discount or a premium or at par. So what is the present market value, and it establishes the relationship between the market value, present market value of shares, and the dividend per share. Dividend per share means dividend per share attracts what amount of dividend is called dividend of share. Clear? Per share. Okay, so dividend yield ratio means it shows the percentage of the market price of share a company annually pays to its shareholders in the form of dividend. Clear? The what actually the dividend yield ratio explains? It explains the percentage form or it explained the its dividend yield percentage. Okay, whenever when we actually multiplied the ratio into 100, we will get the amount in percentage form. So this is all about dividend yield ratio. Then the dividend payout ratio. What do you mean by dividend payout ratio? The dividend payout ratio, it is the fraction of net income a firm pays to his stockholders as dividend. Okay, it is a fraction of payment means it actually discloses what portion of the current earning the company is paying to its shareholders, whether it is to its shareholder or whether the company is plowing back its profit. Okay, as all of us know, the company pays dividend out of the profit. Okay, so there is also a term called retained earning, which is otherwise called as plowing back of profit. Plowing back of profit means what? The company retains some portion of a profit for any future contingency or future any contingent to pay any uncertainty or any contingent liability which can be arises, which may arise in future. So so dividend payout ratio means the company it actually discloses the portion of current earnings the company is paying to its stockholder in the form of dividend, and what portion the company is plowing back. Clear? So the dividend payout ratio, it can be calculated by dividend per share divided by earnings per share. Okay, so the next ratio is return on capital employed. So ROCM. Okay, so return on capital employed means ROCE actually. It is a financial ratio which measures the company's profitability as well as the efficiency with which the capital is being used or the capital is being employed. Clear? In other words, this ratio actually tells us how well a company is generating profits from its capital, so that the capital is employed in a business and what amount of return can be extracted from that employment of capital. So it means how a company is generating a profit, how well. So it is more concerned about the profitability of the company. So the formula of calculating return on capital is return on capital employed ratio equals to net income before interest and tax divided by capital employed multiplied by 100. Net income before interest and tax means here in case of calculating ROCE, we will consider the net income before deducting any sort of interest and any sort of tax from this net income. Clear? So the next ratio is earnings per share. Earnings per share means EPS. It is a very popular ratio which are mostly used and mostly used by various financial analysts. Okay, so it measures how much of income have been earned by each share of a common stock. Clear? In the formula also it is written that company earnings per share EPS ratio equals to net profit minus preferred dividend. Preferred dividend means the dividend which are distributed to the preference shareholders divided by the weighted average number of share outstanding. So what do you mean by shares outstanding? Shares outstanding refers to the company's stock currently held by the shareholders. Clear? So share outstanding means it can also we can call it, it is a part of authorized capital which has already been issued to the shareholders, and that part of capital is already held by the shareholders. So this is called as shares outstanding, means it is already held by all the existing shareholders. So earning per share ratio means net income divided by weighted average number of shares which are outstanding or which are held by the shareholders. So this is all about all the ratios. Then we come to the next category of ratio. This is liquidity ratio. Liquidity ratio means liquidity, as I have already told, liquidity of a firm means ability of a firm to pay off its obligation or liability. So it is also a financial ratio. Whether it also tells us or it indicates whether the company's current assets will be sufficient enough to meet the obligations of a company whenever they are due. So obligations or the liability, when they become due, at that point of time, whether the company has sufficient current assets. Current assets means which will be disposed of, which can easily be disposed of or which can easily be converted into cash or equivalent to cash. Clear? So in the liquidity ratio, we will be discussing three types of ratio, which is current ratio, or which can also called as working capital ratio, then quick ratio, or it is otherwise known as acid test ratio. And there is another ratio which is absolute liquid ratio. Then we will be discussing one by one. First, current ratio. Current ratio means whenever a company is otherwise known as working capital ratio. All of us know actually what do you mean by working capital. Working capital is the difference of current assets and a current liabilities of a firm. So whether current assets is sufficient enough, current assets is sufficient enough to pay the current liability. Clear? So this actually says the current ratio. Current ratio, it tells the investor and analyst how a company can maximize the current assets on its balance to satisfy the current debt and other payables. So if the current assets will not be sufficient enough, then it is a red signal for the company to take precautionary step. So the current assets, the current ratio actually says that the strength of the company to pay the current liabilities. So this is all about current ratio. Then come to quick ratio. Quick ratios means it is the ability of the company to meet the short-term obligation with its most liquid assets. Clear? The most liquid asset. Liquid assets means which are already in a liquid form. Clear? It is otherwise known as acid test ratio. Clear? So the formula of quick ratio is करेंट एसेट्स माइनस इन्वेंटोरी माइनस प्रीपेड एक्सपेंसेस मीन्स करेंट एसेट्स मीन्स व्हिच आर ऑलरेडी placed, which are already included in the company's assets, which are current in nature, which can be converted into cash in the near future. But inventory a term which is excluded while calculating the quick ratio, and also prepaid expenses is also excluded. Why the prepaid expense is excluded from the quick ratio? Because prepaid expenses means expenses incurred in advance, but the benefit of the expenses which are already incurred is not yet been derived by the company. So sometimes prepaid expenses is also treated as an asset, and it also appears in the final account in the asset side of the balance sheet, because the benefit which is yet to be received. So in the accounting, any benefit which is receivable is treated as asset of the company. So in this current assets, that these two items, if they are, can be excluded while calculating the quick ratio. Clear? So this is all about quick ratio, and the next is absolute quick ratio. Absolute quick ratio means the liquidity position of a firm means absolute liquid assets, means cash or bank balance or the marketable securities, also termed as absolute liquid assets, which are already in form of cash. Clear? The company cannot wait to convert the absolute liquid assets because they are already in form of cash. But in case of other liquid assets or other current assets, the company must wait few days or for a short period to convert them into cash. So in absolute liquid assets, they are already in form of cash. So the formula of absolute liquid asset is all the absolute liquid assets divided by current liability. Clear? Current liability, it is it includes cash, bank and marketable securities. Clear? Whether the liquid assets are capable enough to pay the current liabilities. So here there is a standard that while calculating absolute liquid ratio, absolute liquid assets should worth one half of the value of current liabilities. So by putting the formula, if we are getting 0.5 in this formula, then we are at a good position, or we are at a standard position. Clear? Because we have 50% of cash to be paid immediately to the current liabilities or the current obligations. So this is all about absolute liquid ratio. Then the next category of ratios is activity ratio. So what activity ratio states? Activity ratio actually assesses how effectively a company is able to generate revenue in the form of cash or in the form of sales based on its assets, liabilities and capital. Capital means share capital. Okay, so these under activity ratios, these ratios are actually comes under activity ratio, such as inventory turnover ratio, receivable turnover ratio, average collection period, accounts payable turnover ratio, average payment period, assets turnover ratio, working capital turnover ratio, fixed assets turnover ratio, etc. So we will be discussing one by one. First come to inventory turnover ratio. Inventory turnover ratio means it measures how many times a company has sold or replaced its inventory during a certain period of time. Okay, it is actually calculated to see if a business has a excessive inventory in comparison to its sales level. Okay, so it is actually calculated by dividing the cost of goods sold, divided by average inventory cost. Okay, cost of goods sold means cost of goods sold in accounting, there is a formula, opening stock plus net purchase plus direct expenses minus closing stock. Whatever amount we are getting, it is the cost of goods sold. So some in books, in some books also, while calculating inventory turnover ratio, we can take the net sales amount divided by average inventory at cost. So what do you mean by, again, what do you mean by average inventory? Average inventory means the inventory at the beginning of a financial year plus inventory left at the end of the financial year divided by two. It is called average inventory. So inventory turnover ratio means sometimes we can calculate sometimes it is calculated by dividing the net sales divided by average inventory at cost. So it actually measures how many times a company has sold or replaced its inventory during a certain period of time. So this is all about inventory turnover ratio. Then the next is receivable turnover ratio. Receivable turnover ratio means receivable, it is otherwise known as debtors turnover ratio. Debtors are those person who are going, who from whom the company has to receive money or money's worth. Clear? So receivable turnover ratio, what does it indicates? It indicates the receivable turnover ratio. It measures how many times the receivable are collected during a particular period. Clear? So that the, in this formula you can see net credit sales. Net credit sales means how the amount of sales done by a company on credit to the debtors. Clear? Divided by average trade receivables. Okay, so this formula is average receivable means the average trade receivable means what debtors at the beginning of the period plus debtors at the closing of the period divided by two. It is the average trade receivables. Okay, so when we calculate the receivables turnover ratio or debtors turnover ratio, we just put the net credit sales divided by the average debtors or average net trade receivables. Clear? Okay. So this ratio can be used to measure how effective a company is extending credits or collecting debts. Clear? So it is by calculating this ratio, we can judge how a company effectively managing in collecting debts or extending its credit. Clear? So the next point is average collection period ratio. Average collection period ratio means the average collection period represents the average number of days between the date of a credit sale is made and the date of a purchaser pays for that sale. Okay. The company's average collection period is a strong indication of the effectiveness of its accounts receivable from its debtors. Clear? So average collection period means the collection period during which the debtors are usually pay off its debt. Clear? So so debtors are paying the amount after a certain given period. So it actually calculate the number of working days for a given period, okay, during which the debtors are going to pay or debtors are going to clear all their debts, or the company can receive all the receivables which are due from the respective debtor. So the average collection period actually indicates the number. So this formula, so by this formula, we can get the average collection period, number of working days divided by debtors turnover ratio. So debtors turnover ratio means earlier we have already discussed the debtors turnover ratio, whatever the amount we are getting, we just divides it with number of working days. So we can get the average collection period. So this is all about this ratio. The next ratio is account payable. Account payable turnover ratio. Sometimes it is also called creditors turnover ratio. Okay, creditors means there must be certain credit purchase by the firm. Okay, so this ratio shows how many times in a given period a company pays its average account payable. Okay, it is just the opposite of accounts payable turnover ratio. Okay, it is just the opposite of debtors turnover ratio. Clear? So it is this ratio actually shows how many times in a given period, okay, a company pays all the pays its average account payable or pays its dues or all its obligation to the respective creditor. Okay, it is computed by the net credit purchase by average accounts payable. Okay, average accounts payable means how can we get average accounts payable? It is the creditors at the beginning of the period plus creditors at the end of the period divided by 2. Okay, so accounts payable turnover ratio is net credit purchase divided by average accounts payable. Okay, then the next ratio is average payment period ratio. Okay, so it is just the opposite of average collection period ratio. Okay, the formula is average payment period means any accounts payable multiplied by the number of working days divided by net credit purchase. In the earlier formula, in the average collection period, we are dividing with the net credit sales. But in this case, we are dividing the accounts payable multiplied by number of working days divided by net credit purchase. Okay, then the next ratio is assets turnover ratio means it actually measures the efficiency of a company to use its assets in generating sales revenue or sales income of a company. Okay, so higher the asset turnover ratio, better the company is performing, because it is calculated by dividing the net sales divided by average fixed assets. So it naturally assets turnover ratio means it naturally higher the ratio means higher better performance of the company, or the company is generating more revenue. Okay, more revenue from its assets. So this is all about assets turnover ratio. And the next one is working capital turnover ratio. Working capital turnover ratio can be calculated by dividing the cost of goods sold by net working capital. Okay, cost of goods sold, as we have discussed earlier, what is cost of goods sold? So it is computed by dividing the cost of goods sold by net working capital, and it represents how many times the working capital has been turned over the period. Okay, how many times the working capital has been turned over the period? The working capital, this ratio is calculated by dividing net annual sales. Okay, where the cost of goods sold is sometimes replaced by net annual sales or by average amount of working capital. Okay, the next ratio is fixed assets turnover ratio. Fixed asset turnover ratio means the ratio of sales to the value of fixed assets. It actually indicates how well the business is using its fixed assets. How far is the business is capable to use its fixed assets to generate sales revenue. So it indicates the efficiency of a business. Clear? By the usage of fixed assets. So the formula is fixed assets turnover ratio is equal to net sales divided by average fixed assets. Net sales divided by average fixed assets. So in the questions also, all the items of whatever ratios you are going to calculate, all the items are already given in the questions, and you have to just put the formula and to get the answer. And on the basis on the answer, we can conclude the efficiency, the profitability, the liquidity, the solvency, whatever you are going to analyze analyze regarding a particular item or regarding the company or any business organization. So this is all about fixed assets turnover ratio. Then we are moving to the fourth category of ratio, which is solvency ratio. Okay, we are just I am just briefly explaining because the time is getting late. So first is debt equity ratio. Debt equity ratio means debt to equity. Debt to equity means the total liabilities divided by the total shareholders equity. Debt means outsiders contribution and equity means owners contribution. Clear? So it is the ratio of debt to equity shareholders. It means the whether the business organization is able to finance its obligation through cash and reserve and is dependent on or is dependent on the creditors, because this ratio actually shows whether the company is capable enough to pay its liabilities or pay its liability from its own fund or it is dependent on the outside creditor. So this ratio actually indicates the debt or the equity of a particular business concern. Then the next is proprietary ratio. Proprietary ratio is also known as equity ratio. Equity ratio means it is the proportion of the shareholders' equity to the total assets. Okay. Proprietary ratio means it is the proportion of the total equity to the total assets. So there is a standard that 0.5:1. Okay. Higher than 0.5 or higher than 50% ratio here is always better for the long-term solvency of the firm. So it holds the financial position in a better way or it holds the financial position. It indicates whether the financial position of a firm is going to be stable in a long run or not. So this it by calculating proprietary ratio, we can know the long-term solvency of a particular firm. Then the next ratio is fixed assets to equity ratio. Fixed assets to equity ratio means it is the contribution of the stakeholders and the contribution of the debt sources in fixed assets of the company. Okay, so it is calculated by dividing the fixed assets divided by the stockholders' equity, means the equity of the shareholder or the equity amount. Okay, so it is the relation between fixed assets to stockholders' equity. Clear? So we will move to the next ratio, which is called as capital gearing ratio. Capital gearing ratio means it is the ratio which is very useful to analyze the capital structure of a company. Okay, so capital structure of a company, and it is computed by dividing the stockholders' equity divided by the fixed cost bearing funds. Okay, so what do you mean by fixed cost bearing funds? Fixed cost bearing funds means it includes long term loans, bonds, debenture, preferred stock. It is also called the financial leverage, and it is also measure the financial strength of a company. Okay, so a gearing ratio or a capital gearing ratio higher than 50% is typically considered as a very high levered or very high geared. So it is a very good, if the ratio is more than 50% or 50%, it is good, it is considered as good for the company. Okay, then the next ratio. Okay, in that actually we have covered all the ratios in the ratio analysis chapter, and I am just briefing all the advantages of ratio analysis. Forecasting and planning, we can forecast, we can plan out for the future by the help of ratio analysis. We can budgeting means on the basis of past experience or the past data, we can budget or we can estimate the future activities of a business concerned by the help of the ratio analysis. Then measurement of operational efficiency. Okay, how what is the efficiency of a organization, or how to measure the efficiency of an organization to execute all the operational activities. So this by ratio analysis we can also measure the efficiency of operational efficiency. Then communication, we can able to communicate clear. So we can able to inform the others. So by putting just an amount of putting just an percentage, and the other person will able to easily judge the performance of a concern. So it is very good method of communication also. Then inter firm comparison. Okay, then indication of liquidity position, as all of as these actually liquidity position, it indicates whether the company is liquid enough or capable enough. Okay, indication of profitability, what is the trend of profit of a particular concern, whether the profit is increasing or decreasing, what is the trend line shows. Okay, so these also indicates the profitability of a business. Signal for industry sickness. Okay, so whether the ratio is good or bad. So a lots of bad amount or a lots of bad conclusion which we are getting by ratio analysis. If most of the percentage we came across, or most of the percentage we achieved, or we found in the ratio analysis, it is strong indication that industry is going to be sick in the near future. Clear. So accordingly, precautionary steps must be taken. So the last point is decision making. So all of you know it is a very important tool for decision making purpose of a company. So these are the advantages of a company. Then there are also some limitations of a company, means limitations of financial statements, historical information means as the data is purely based on historical data, we cannot predict the future out of that. So different accounting policies, rules or regulation may change from time to time. So it actually actually creates a lot of problem in comparing different ratios. Clear. So lack of standard comparison, quantitative analysis. Clear. Ratio analysis means it analyzes the numerical data. So it also ignores the qualitative aspects. Clear. As I have already told in earlier in this class, that qualitative phenomena is totally ignored or from this ratio analysis or this analysis of financial statement, as all the analysts or all the managers will have to ultimately take their decision by their experience and skills also. So window dressing means what we know, manipulation of the financial terms. So this can also be a very disadvantages of ratio analysis. Okay, changes in price level. So inflation we have already discussed. So this can be an limitation of this ratio analysis. Then this for the So the ratio analysis is over. Then come to trend analysis. Trend analysis means it is another tool for analyzing the financial statement. So trend analysis means it is a statistical technique. It evaluates the organizational financial information over a period of time. Over a period of time means periods may be considered, or period may be measured in months, quarters or years, depending upon the circumstances. Okay, so the main purpose or goal or objective is to calculate the amount change, clear, the absolute change as well as the percentage change from one period to another period. So trend analysis is a very useful statistical tool. It actually determines the future movements of the organization based on the historical trends or the past data. Clear. It also predicts the behavioral aspect or the future behavior of a company. Clear. So under this step, what is the procedure for calculating the trend? So 1 year, first year is taken as base year, okay, as base year, and the figures of the base year is taken as 100, okay, 100, and the trend percentage is calculated in relation to the base year. On the basis of 100, other amounts is are actually calculated. So some amount may come 75, 80. So these amounts are actually comes out in terms of percentage. Okay, so there is an illustration. Okay, all of you can see 2000 the sales and profit figures of a particular organization in 2010, 11, 12, 13, and 14. Okay, in 2010 the sales is 1000. It is actually in 10 lakhs. Actually, it is in thousands. The amount is in thousand. So in 2011 it is 1200, and 2012 it is 1500. And side by side we have also the data of profit. Okay, so how we can analyze the trend? Just see the slide. The base year is taken as 100, and the base year is taken 2010 is actually taken as the base year. So if the sales is 1000 and the trend percentage is 100, then the 2000 in 2011 when the sales increases to 1200, then trend is also increases to 120. So accordingly, when in 2014 the sales is increased from 1000 to 2900, then automatically the trend is increasing from 2000 sorry 100% to 290%. So likewise the profit is also increasing and the trend is also increasing. So taking the base year as 100, we are going to set a trend or set a trend percentage by of a particular item. So in this example, we have already taken the sales figure and the profit figure. You can also calculate the trend of other items in a financial statement also. So here the trend line. So look at the trend line also. Trend line means when we put the line in a graph paper. So the sales trend and profit trend, the graph is moving, or the graph is sloping upward. Okay, so we can interpret that the sales have continuously increased in the years up to 2014. Okay, the percentage of 2014 is 290 compared to 100 as a base year. Clear? So the increase in sale is quite satisfactory also. Clear? Because the sale trend is moving upward during the years. Okay, though the figures of profits has also increased over the year. Okay, but critically, if we examine the trend, it can be concluded that the profit is not increasing as compared to the sales. Clear? So we can conclude that when this you can clearly see that the profit line is below the sale. The amount of sale increased it not according to the amount of sales is amount of sales line is moving upward, and this profit line is below the sales line. So it is not in the same manner as the sales. Okay, so this may be because we have to increase the cost of production. So increase.
Hello, sir. Any problem is there? In a voice is not coming.
To the comparative statement. Hello, hello, hello. Hello, hello. Am I audible, sir?
Now you are audible. You are paused for few seconds.
Okay, 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 sir. Sir, there might be some internet problem. Okay. So now the learners, you can see in the slide comparative statements. Comparative statements are the statements of financial position at different positions at different periods of time. The elements of financial position are shown in a comparative form. So we can compare each and every item in different period of time. Okay. So mostly the comparative statements are prepared in the for the with an objective to compare 2 years statements. Clear? 2 year statements. It may be a comparative balance sheet or it may be a comparative profit and loss account. So what do you mean by comparative balance sheet? Comparative balance sheet means balance sheet of 2 years. Okay. So here balance sheet as on a particular date. We have a balance sheet of which is actually the year ending 31st December 2007 and 31st December 2008. We have current assets, we have fixed assets, we have long-term investment, we have total assets, we have current liability, we have long-term debt, we have owner's equity that is again subdivided into equity share capital and reserves and surplus. So this is a balance sheet of 2 years. Of the year ending 2017 and the year ending 2018. So we can compare it by this format. We are actually just draw a format and place all the data, and we are the first column is the particulars column, next column is the 2017 the data in the amount of 2017, and the third column is 2018's data, and the fourth column is plus minus sign, means there is an absolute change. Is there any absolute increase or decrease in the particular item of a balance sheet? Okay, suppose the cash and bank balance. We had actually 23,600 in 2017 year end, but in the 2018 year end, we have cash and bank balance of rupees worth what 2,000 rupees only. So there is a minus figure of 21,600. Okay, whether in the 21,600, if we convert it into percentage, then it will come around 91.5% decrease in the cash balance. Okay, we can conclude that the 91% decrease in the cash balance. Okay, so we can see the plant and machinery. Plant and machinery means 62,000 in the year ending 2017 and 157,200 in the year ending 2018. So there is an absolute increase by rupees 95,200. So if we will convert it into percentage, then there is an increase or there is an increment of 153.5% in the plant and machinery. So it is very simple. All of you can easily prepare the comparative balance sheet. All the data are actually already given in the question. You have to draw a format and you have to made extra two columns. One column is of absolute change in the items, and one column is the percentage change in the items. So accordingly, you can draw the conclusion. So now come to the income statement and comparative income statement. So this is a comparative income statement. So here we have net sales, we have gross profit, we have all administrative selling expenses, and we have profit before tax, we have profit after tax also. This so we have data of profitability statement, or we have data of a income statement or statement of profit and loss of 2017 and 2018 also. Okay, then we can compare the statement, the same, exactly the same format we are going to compare. So we actually just put all those items in a table, and additional two columns we have to add. So one column is for the absolute change and one column is for the percentage change. So accordingly, you can prepare easily the comparative income statement also. Clear? Then come to the common size statement. Common size statement is slightly different from comparative statement, because it is the statement where we can analyze the items within a particular year, clear? But in case of comparative statement, we are analyzing the item of two different years, clear? Common size statement also, we have common size balance sheet and common size income statement. Okay, so here the total assets of a firm and total sales of a firm is taken as 100, and accordingly the percentage is calculated. So I can show it, common size income statement. Okay, so common size income statement means, as all of you can see, revenues is taken as 100%, and accordingly cost of goods sold, revenue is taken as 100% means 315,000 revenue. So it is taken as 100%, and then cost of goods sold comes to 212,500. So it is 60, cost of goods sold is 67% of revenue. Okay, gross profit is 102,500, and this is 33% of the revenue. Means that gross profit is 33% of the revenue, we can easily say. Okay, net profit means 2%. Come to the last item of this statement. 2% means net profit is 2% of the revenue. Clear? As revenue has already taken as 100%. Okay, so this is all about common size statement and comparative statement. So for this, actually this session is over on my part, and over to Srimay sir if he wants to say something.
Thank you, Kiro sir. Anjana Kashyap is there. I would request Anjana, if you have any doubt, then instead of writing on the chat box, you can ask by unmuting your mic.
Perhaps she is not there, sir.
Okay.
So, sir, has she asked some questions to you?
No question has come.
Okay, she is writing, no sir, I have no doubt.
Okay. So again, I would like to thank Mr. Kirat Chandra Maharana. He has delivered his topic very precisely, and he explained many of the things, those were ratios and many of the implications, that really it is really enlightening to us. Students might be got benefited from that. At the same time, I would like to thank our technical support, Dr. Ansuman Jena, to give the support throughout. So thank you so much. With this, we'll come to the end of this session. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Ansuman sir. Thank you, Srimay sir.
Thank you, sir.